God's faithful live as oaks of righteousness. Let us grow strong and true in this Advent season. Welcome in announcements now.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're in our third week of Advent. We're getting closer. The excitement is growing. Yesterday, we were Christmas caroling over at Providence Place. What a fun time. Singing through the hallways, making two stops along the way to sing. They loved it. And I think we loved it just as much. If only we could have that kind of joy year round. Wouldn't that be great? Wouldn't it be great? Remember, next Sunday there is no service in the morning. It will be at 7 p.m. If you're 7 p.m. is too late, Otterbein will be having theirs at 5 p.m. So I don't know what it's going to feel like next week to have the morning off. I might be driving here and have to turn around and go back home. So, are there any other announcements that I need to make today? Okay, not seeing any. Let's continue on with the lighting of the Advent wreath.
Thank you.
have to say, as they were singing that, I was watching angels dancing around the church. Did you not see that? Thank you for that.
We'll now have call to worship. If you're able to stand, please stand. When the Lord restores our fortunes,
we are like those who dream.
Our mouths are filled with laughter.
Our hearts sing with shouts of joy.
Worship the Lord of our salvation.
Worship the Lord.
We'll now have passing of the peace. I think you can sit down now. You can sit down. We'll now have the unison prayer. God of dreams, you have done great things for your people. From times of old, you awakened the faithful to the dawn of your glory. Fill our mouths with laughter. Loose our tongues with shouts of joy. Anoint us with the oil of gladness and make it known among all people that we live as oaks of righteousness. The plantings of the Lord. Amen.
Any youth who are present, please come forward. Hi, Calvin. Yeah, I think that's funny too. Yeah. Good morning. How's everybody this morning? You got a thumbs up, everyone? So, you got a name? Does he have a name? Okay. He's shaking his head, yes, he has a name, but I guess we're not allowed to hear his name. Okay. Oh, he forgot what his name was. Okay, that's all right. Oh. Somebody else wanted to do children's morning. I'm on strike two already. Let's try this again. Which candle was lit for this week? First week? Second week? So which one was lit for this week? The pink one. Why the pink one? Because it's different. The pink one is for Mary, the mother of Jesus. It represents joy. Joy. What is joy? Can you tell me what joy is? The littlest little toy here has joy. A whole lot of joy. Did you have joy yesterday when you were singing? Did the people listening to the music, did they have joy? We're going to have to find some kids that have voices. I'm doing both sides here. Like having a conversation by yourself and you're losing it real quick. And they're laughing. They love doing this to me. So the joy, what joy did Mary have?
Happy joy.
Happy joy? Why was she full of joy? No?
She was carrying a baby. Is that not joy? Calvin, is that not joy? I'm getting the same amount of answer from Calvin as I'm getting from these two older ones here. So yes, Mary was full of joy because she knew she was carrying the child, God's child, a holy child, a special child, just like every child is special. Do you ever feel yourself as being special? All right, that's it. I'm strike three. Yes, you are special. You're not only special to your parents, but you're special to us. And you're special to God, who loves you so much and is so full of joy because you are here with us. We're full of joy. It would not be Christmas season without the youth. So I want you to, I'm going to re-ask that question. Are you special? Well, I got one of these now. Yes, you are. Possibly. I'm getting closer. Well, I'm going to say from myself, the three youth that are here today are very special in my heart. And I know the rest of the congregation feels the same way. And we look forward to Sunday mornings when we can see you and talk with you. And some of us like to pass the baby around. He has so many aunts and grandmoms and He is special. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy that you're giving us through these youth. We ask that you bless them and keep them and let them know how special they are. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may go to Sunday school.
Scripture reading, it's Genesis 12, 1 through 3. The Lord had said to Abraham, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make you, your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. Now we'll have the Nicene Creed. It's in the your hymnal and number 880. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he arose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seateth at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one Baptist for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Join with me in a prayer of illumination. O God, open our ears to hear, our eyes to see,
our hearts to receive what you say to us today.
Amen. The sermon text today is taken from Psalm 98, verses 1 to 6. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
This week's sermon is based on the song, Joy to the World. I'm thankful that you've decided to join us today, either here in person or watching us online. We're in this fantastic series called Christmas Playlist, which gives a bit of a twist to the traditional Christmas series by incorporating several of our favorite songs of this season. Hopefully you've known the songs. We started out with the first Noel, and then Away in a Manger. Even if you haven't heard those two before, I have no doubt that you will know this one, Joy to the World. Is there anyone here today that could use some more joy, some more good news in their life? I just read Psalm 98, verse 1 to 6. It's a wonderful psalm of praise. We sing the song, Joy to the World, celebrating the fact that, as the song says, the Lord is come. That is our reality today as believers. So this morning I want to tell you a little bit about joy from the Bible itself, helping us grasps the greater understanding of that which leads us into the type of praise talked about in Psalm 98. So let's jump in. Earlier in week one, we talked a little bit about the difference between joy and happiness. Do you remember that? Joy seems to be something the Holy Spirit puts in us that we simply cannot contain. In fact, the joy is one of the fruits of the Spirit outlined in Galatians 5, verse 22 to 23. It is something that is meant to be present and even guide us through the exciting but also the difficult situations we face. Many would refer to it as the key indicator of the follower of Christ, which is why we must talk about what true joy looks like today, and most importantly, why we have it. See, joy helps us remember. In Psalm 98, one of the favorite concepts of all Scripture is that of remembering. Some of us here today have good memories, while others have some memory problems. I can remember what I want to remember. If I don't want to remember, I just toss it off to the side. That's what I call selective memory. There are other things that I want to remember that I will always remember. Hopefully the joy that is in my life. Regardless of how our memory is, we serve God, who constantly remembers his promises. If God makes a promise, he does not forget it. But how often do God's people forget his goodness and his faithfulness in our lives? How often do we forget? In Exodus chapter 15, the people of Israel have just been delivered from captivity in Egypt through the miraculous parting of the Red Sea. We all remember that story when God separated the Red Sea so that the Egyptians could go through. Then they sing a song to the Lord of deliverance, one that mirrors in many ways the words in Psalm 98. They are clearly experiencing great joy because of their freedom. However, not long after, we begin to read about their complaints. They were complaining that life was hard. They were complaining that maybe they should go back and be where they were before. Now I know what you're thinking. How could the Israelites complain when they had just seen God provide for them by opening the Red Sea for them to escape? How could they not trust God after that? That's easy for us to say, but hard for them to do. But if we had not been in this situation, what would we do? Maybe our response would have been similar to that of the Israelites. Did you ever have a time in your life when you had a hard time remembering all that God has done for you in your life? Is there a practice or a rhythm that you now keep in your life to help you remember the promises and the goodness of God? Do you remember how good God has been to you? Let us see. We all tend to have selective memory. Often, we will think back to our past in certain seasons and remember only the lowest points, the times that frustrate us the most. This is what compounds onto our current frustrations and spirals us out of control. Eventually, we need someone to blame, a scapegoat for all our problems. And more often than not, that ends up being God. For the Israelites, they thought back to the dark season of their lives in Egypt as if it were far better than their present life. Free reality. It goes to show once again that we as people do not have a very good memory, and how soon we seem to forget God's faithfulness. But what does the Bible say about God's memory? In Psalm 98, verse 3, it says, He has remembered His promise to love and be faithful to His people. This should bring us abundant joy. Here's what I need you to hear today. Even when we are unfaithful, God is always faithful to His promises. Many times in the Old Testament, He remembers His promises. But what do these promises sound like? We heard read Genesis 12, verses 1 to 3. God is one who gives good gifts, one in which is the gift of joy through the power of the Holy Spirit within us. We have joy because of the righteousness of God. We do not just have joy because God's promises, but we also have His righteousness. Someone who is acting out in righteousness is literally one who is conformed by the will of God. If God is righteous Himself, He serves as a model for us, teaching us what righteousness looks like and sounds like, most clearly through the person and ministry of Jesus Christ. In Romans 1, chapter 1, verse 17, the verse helps us to see that by placing our faith in the work and the person of Jesus Christ, we are made righteous. This is not an act through us. Therefore, we are seen as righteous in God's sight. But maybe today, you look at the person of Jesus as we read about in the gospel accounts and say to yourself, this is someone who is perfect. I'm not perfect. Was there anyone counted as righteous from the Old Testament who was broken and sinful like us? I believe so. We can turn in the Bible to one that comes to mind right off the top of my head. It is Job. The Bible says that Job was a man who lived a blameless life, one of the qualities of a righteous life. In fact, this man, Job, was described this way by God Himself. This is the kind of man I desired to be in my life, but as we said earlier today, it is easy to have joy when things are going well for us in life. But where is the joy when things aren't going so good? What about when our situation takes that turn for the worse? This is exactly what happens in the story of Job, as Satan takes most of his possessions and his family away from Job and leaves him only with his wife. How did Job respond? Job responded, surely like someone who seeks to continue living a righteous and blameless life. But it certainly isn't an easy way to live. There's times in my life, I'm sure there's times in your life, that you can think back and remember a time when things didn't go just as well as you'd like them to go. When things went bad and you responded poorly to it. You were frustrated and maybe even angry. But somehow, against all odds, You were able to maintain your joy through the power of the Holy Spirit. God can handle our frustrations. He can handle our pain. There are seasons we all go through that cause us grief. But even in the middle of our grief and pain, we can understand if we have placed our faith in Jesus. God has already counted us as righteous because of his Son. Therefore, we still have reason to rejoice. Maybe in this very season you find yourself in right now, you suddenly lost a loved one. Or you don't understand why God would allow you to sit in this pain. Or maybe it's a job, a career that you felt would take you into retirement. But that narrative has now changed and you're in pain because of it. But right here in the middle of your pain, hear me on this, you know Jesus. You know righteousness. If you know Jesus, you know hope. If you know Jesus, you know comfort. If you know Jesus, you know peace. And therefore, if you know Jesus, you know the source of all true joy. Remember him and his righteousness in your life. Jesus has rescued you and I from sin and death. We have joy because of his rescue. I want us to land where the last thing I would love to share with you about why we have joy. According to Psalm 98 and other books in the Bible, we have joy because of God's rescue plan for us. When Jesus Christ came to this earth in the form of a child born in a manger, as we talked about the last week, he brought his plan of rescue for humanity even closer than it was before. Let's revisit the beginning of verse 2 in our psalm once again. He announced his victory. And what is this victory? Through the incarnation and the crucifixion and the resurrection of Christ, this victory is for all humanity over sin and death. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the whole world." Can we repeat that together? John 3:16 said, "For God so loved the whole world." And now we see because of Christ, there is a way back to imitate the communion with God. What was broken in the Garden of Eden because of Adam's sin has now been restored through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Paul says it another way. This is the promise of all promises. Christ has reversed the curse of sin. He has given us a better identity to be part of, one of righteousness. As the song says, the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love should lead us to a place of rejoicing. As Christmas approaches, we can know that our King has come and rescued us from the trap of sin. We've covered a lot of ground today, from the Exodus out of Egypt to the Psalms, to Paul and the book of Romans. Through it all, there's one truth that remains the same. The righteous, faithful love of God for his people. This, because of this truth, is why we rejoice today. It's because of him that we can have the audacity to sing joy to the world. The King has come. It's important to remember that God's love is powerful enough for the entire world and specific enough for your life. He knows your every need. He knows your silent prayers. He knows your every struggle. He knows your hopes and your dreams. He is a good, good Father. And today I want to invite you into a relationship with Him. He is the fountain of eternal and everlasting joy. Amen. Please stand if you're able for our next hymn, O for a Thousand Tongues We Sing, verses 1 to 3. It's up on the screen or in your hymnal on page 57. Seated. We now come to the time in our service for our praise, our joys, our concerns, any prayer requests this morning.
I would just like to have my wife's going into a procedure on Tuesday, so I would like to have prayer for successful.
Prayers for a successful operation, that was a tongue twister for me, and complete and full healing. And if you leave me know exactly before that time, just send me a text or an email. I will be in prayer during the time of her surgery. Anybody else? I think we need to keep Israel, Palestine in our prayers. This past Tuesday, I had a clergy meeting with the bishop, and the bishop talked to us about his son-in-law, who is from Palestine, and his family's still there. And right before the war broke out, his son-in-law and daughter and his grandchildren were there to visit. He told the story of how his son-in-law here will not say where he's from. The whole time he lived in the United States, which he still does, he did not claim to be from Palestine. He left people on to believe that he was from, let me see, where did he tell us he was from? India. He told us that he would say he was from India. And the reason being is because his son-in-law found that there was so much hatred in this country for those who are different, those who come from other countries. What a shame. The bishop put up on the screen for us to see the woman that we all seen in the news, the Jewish woman who was killed. I believe she was a school teacher. His daughter knew her. He also put up a picture of the 6 or 7 year old that was shot and killed by his neighbor because he was Jewish. It brought the bishop to tears because his grandson is 6 or 7. I don't remember what she said, but it was around the same age as that child. An innocent life taken just because of who they are. We have a lot of work to do here in this, our own country. We need to get rid of the hatred and replace it with the joy and the love, not just in this season, but year round. And we as Christians, I believe, are being called to do just that. Yesterday when we were singing at Providence Place, I made sure at the end not only to wish a Merry Christmas to the Christians, and the one resident was wondering if being Catholic was a Christian. I said, I think we all fall in the same category. But we also wish those who were Jewish a happy Hanukkah, which meant a lot to them. That's how we begin to repair relationships, respect their holidays as they respect ours. Any more prayer concerns for today? If not, let us go into prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise your name for all that you have done for us this week and all that you continue to do. We don't deserve even part of what you give us, but you give us your grace anyway. Lord, we pray for all amongst us who are sick this day, those who are facing surgery. May you guide the hands of the surgeons and the nurses who will be taking care of the patient. Most of all, Lord, be with the patients and be with their families as they go through the surgeries. And if it be your will, Lord, bring complete healing to them. Lord, we pray for all who are facing wartime. They're facing wars, not knowing what their lives are going to end up being like. They're losing everything. There are many wars around this world, too many for us to mention. Help us. Help you guide this world in showing them your love, your kindness, your joy. Lord, we pray for all who are away from home this holiday season. Let their loved ones know that they are okay. Let them know that their loved ones are okay. And if it be your will, Lord, let the families reunite with peace and harmony. Lord, we pray for our president and all who serve under him. We pray for our governors and all who serve under them, and our mayors. May you guide them and help them make the decisions that was best for our country and for us. Let them know what your will is for us. Lord, we thank you for the precious sounds of the little ones. What a reminder to us of the baby Jesus. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our collection plate is up front here. I will announce now on Christmas Eve, we will take up the collection as we used to do with the ushers, and we will reintroduce the doxology at that time, and then we will continue the doxology throughout as we go back to doing our offering the way we're doing it today. It was just our way of how to reintroduce the doxology to everyone. So if you would please stand. Those who want to make an offering to our church who are online, you may do so on our website, or you may do so by sending your offering into the church. We thank you in advance. Please stand. Join me in the prayer of dedication. God of peace, you have restored our hope and sanctified our dreams. May this offering express the joy we feel for the gift of your salvation. May our gifts reflect our wonder and gratitude for being clothed in the garments of salvation and the robes of righteousness. May our lives and our very lives help restore the dreams of the downhearted and fill the hungry with good things. Amen. We will now sing our last hymn, Joy to the World, number 246 in the hymnal and on the screen. This benediction, go forth in love and joy and serve the Lord
And from the way you serve the Lord and you show your joy, you're going to spread the word of God to those who need it. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen.